excited to be here. I really enjoy coming to Grover School every year, and I'm excited to teach this class. And one thing that I want to be clear about with this class is it is what to look for when looking for land. It's not necessarily just like a class on how to look for land. Do you guys see that distinction? So if anyone's looking for specifically how to look for land, this might not be the perfect class. So please feel free to leave now if that's your question. So I'm gonna get started here in a second. I'm going to pass around. Everyone have their worksheet, the land search worksheet. Okay, perfect.
Sorry, that's all we have.
I want to offer you all that if you sign up for our newsletter, which is really awesome, you get monthly reminders about happenings in the garden and forest and homestead, and this can be really helpful. Like, it's kind of this like get to do list. I'm all good. And thank you so much. And you can get a bonus, which is a sheet that you can take with you to different parcels that you're looking at, and I'll send that to you within a week after this class if you sign up for the newsletter. So it's a fun little bonus. So here we go. And yeah, I'm now. So just hopping right into things. Y'all are probably here for a reason. So what is it that you are not satisfied with about not owning land or getting on? Anybody? Yes.
The challenge with sustainable utilities.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Needing to buy into these nasty corporations that supply you with electricity. Anybody else? Yeah.
Not having enough space to grow what I want to grow.
Very fair. That makes a lot of sense. Very challenging. Yes.
Not having space to be loud.
Yes. Loud or quiet, my people.
Anybody else?
Yeah. Room for animals.
Yes, that's a huge one. Not having enough room for animals. And really wanting to have animals. Yeah.
Don't look forward to make sure your site's healthy. Like what past uses have been.
Yeah, and if you're moving from rental to rental, it's not really worth like investing in testing and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Okay, so rent traps. Rent in the Asheville area. How many of y'all live fairly locally? It's gotten really expensive. It's pretty crazy. So I think that's a really big one. And then you brought up the lack of privacy and lack of autonomy. Anybody parents here? So kids growing up without a connection to land, I think, is a really big one. And we've covered the rent ups, lots of things. So just to give you a reality check, owning or co-owning land will probably be, ooh, I figured something out yesterday, ooh, more work than you have ever dreamed of. In fact, the to-do list never ends. You have to have really strong boundaries with the to-do list. I take a Sabbath day every week, Mondays. People have had this figured out for a really long time, but I just hadn't. There was this 60-year-old black preacher from Atlanta that took my Earth Skills program several years ago. And he's like, you know, Sabbath is really important. And he said he took his art next to me, so I was like, okay, after teaching. This sounds great. So, yeah, you're about to embark on a lot of work. There's this little dirty secret about permaculture. Like there's this, people think, like I do a lot of teaching on permaculture, and there's this thought that if you plant a perennial landscape, that then it takes care of itself. It's totally ridiculous. Like perennials require lots of maintenance, and annuals require lots of maintenance, and roads require lots of maintenance, and buildings require lots of maintenance. If you plan really well ahead of time, you can get rid of some of that maintenance, but no matter what, you're going to have quite a bit of maintenance. But connection with land is full of profoundly deep and meaningful rewards. y'all want to move towards with getting it? I'm just going to stare. That was really tricky and cool with the what are you all wanting when you're thinking about biting off this gigantic responsibility of stewarding land?
Projects. Just have projects.
Piddling.
What's that?
Very, I call it piddling. Like, piddling. Just, it's really fun. Anybody else?
Being able to plan like a year of knowing what food is coming in.
Yeah.
To control that.
Yeah, totally. Totally, that makes sense. You will have to let go of control of some, though. Those pests sometimes have other ideas. Anybody else?
I want to be able to host, people.
Nice.
Yeah. All the people, you know, give them a nice place to learn and stay.
Nice. That's awesome. That's really sweet. I like that.
Yeah. This area needs a sheep dairy farm.
Uh-huh. I would love some sheep dairy. I would love that.
I need it every day.
And I see you are the woman who's going to make that happen.
Yeah.
Awesome.
You know Whispering Pines in Malden, South Carolina, Debbie? The only sheep dairy farm in the area.
Huh. Cool. Well, I'm excited about you making it happen. That's awesome. Anybody else?
Commitment to communities.
Yeah.
You know, like, really got to be part of something now.
Totally. And we're actually going to talk about that a fair amount during this class. I think that is a really smart thing to be looking forward to. In Barnardsville, where I live, over the last 7 years, we've created a community on Sugar Creek Road and beyond Sugar Creek Road, but I don't go more than 5 miles for meeting pretty much any of my social needs. It's pretty awesome. And my daughter's social needs, which is really, really, really cool. So things I was thinking were connection with people, like you're saying, and connection with the land, growing food, which several people brought up, growing your own medicine, community, ownership, autonomy, building soil. That's one thing that I encountered when I was moving around a lot and growing was frustration around not being able to build soil and be able to reap the rewards of building that soil. Connecting with land, building and tinkering, which is how many of y'all are interested in building? Yeah. A lot of work. I mean, it's one of my deepest passions, but it is a lot of work. Children being connected to the land and feeling safe. So, why listen to me? I'm going to tell you why. I have lived in all sorts of places. So, I think it's a really good idea before you buy land to live in lots of different places and learn things from all of those different places, learn from other people's mistakes. And at this point, my classes and my apprentices get to learn from my mistakes, which is great. And hopefully those mistakes are at a higher level of mistake because I've had so much experience with other people's mistakes that then I can take them to the next level. But so I started out when I was 18 living in a housing cooperative, an urban housing cooperative, and then I moved a little later to a 100-person commune. I lived in a squatted social center in Barcelona and ran a big community garden there. I then moved to a bark hut in Madison County and practiced primitive skills and tanned deer hides and grew a big garden. And then, anyone have aspirations to live as part of a couple in the middle of nowhere? Yeah? Well, I don't recommend it so much. I've done it down a 2-mile gravel road. Those are actually some friends that were visiting us. But yeah, so I did that. And in an adobe roundhouse on its southern slope. And finally, I purchased and built, with a lot of help, Wild Abundance. So Wild Abundance is an education center about 20 minutes north of Asheville. And that's where I live now. And we have lots of people, lots of community living in the area and we welcome the students there. Kind of like twice a month during the green season. So I've helped hundreds of people through land consultations and through classes figure out how to and get onto land. You can do it. Do it. Okay. But you're you're gonna need to understand that when you make the choice about which land you're gonna partner with, like we're really talking about partnership here. Did anybody read my description? And it was, mm-hmm. I thought it was very funny. Mm-hmm. That's just me. Sometimes I think I'm funny and no one else thinks I'm funny. But if you laugh, then it really like helps me. So you're going to have to compromise, but you also want to hold your ideals and your dreams very close as you're looking at the land. And definitely when I say you will need to compromise, that doesn't mean that you should say yes to the first 10, 15, 20 pieces of land that you look at. Getting educated is a really good idea. There's lots of different ways to get educated. There's flyers up here. The Earth Skills and Permaculture Immersion is a really good way for you to get a deep understanding of how you want to live on land. So anyone got concerns or fears? There's some gratuitous baby pictures in this slideshow, and that's because I have a 16-month-old, and I think these pictures are very funny and cute. But if anyone does not, you can just look away. So anyone got any concerns or fears? We had like 15 of them come up yesterday. It was really, really good. Anybody? Yeah.
I've heard it's harder to get a loan for a property than for like property with a house on it.
Definitely harder. Definitely harder. There are ways around that, for sure. And you can go through, I'm forgetting the name right now, but if you email me, I can get it back to you. But there's, I think it's like Carolina Farm Credit or something like that, where you can get loans just for a property. They're not as easy to get them. But luckily we're at a time, luckily and unluckily, we're at a time when this whole financial bubble is like rebubbling, and part of that is people offering lots of loans to people. So this is actually a pretty decent time to get a loan. Anybody else? Any fears coming up?
Yeah. One of my fears is that I buy land, the perfect piece of land, and none of my neighbors want anything to do with me.
Yeah, that's hard. We're going to discuss this maybe from the before you buy land sort of aspect. Yeah. But I think that something that you can do is do a lot of social networking, and maybe some of these people who are looking for land might be interested in buying a piece of land that's next to you, as it will inevitably come up for sale. I mean, it can take, you know, 5, 10, 15 years, but if you have a list of people to call when something comes up for sale, you are really doing well. And in fact, I just recently maneuvered the sale of my next door neighbor's house to one of my best friends who's my permaculture co-teacher and has a daughter who's 6 months younger than my daughter. But it took some patience and being like, I think this person wants to sell their house. They just bought this other thing. They're going to be short on money. Maybe they'll just, you know, broach the subject. And then to my friend, like, so, do you really want to raise your daughter in West Asheville? and then magically, like, made the two things come together. So I think that once you're on land, there are ways of dealing with that, but it takes time. Anybody else have any concerns that come up? Yeah.
My concern is actually the polarity of that, is that I'll have land, but I won't get any privacy or time alone because it'd be such a great spot.
You have land?
Just the opposite concern,
yeah.
Where that there are a lot of friends and connections that I have that are really into the whole aspect of community and permaculture,
yeah.
And that to have that space would be a really great meeting point. But would I get enough of that time that feels like it is alone, isolated, having some time to myself?
Yeah, that's a really good question. That's a really good question. That probably involves setting some strong boundaries.
Yeah.
Like, I have had a boundary in the past, although my daughter, Bayborn, has totally thrown this off, but that I don't talk to anybody before 9 a.m., which, including my apprentices, and including anyone who lives on the land, and including my neighbors, it's just like, if you talk to me before 9 a.m., then that's like my me time, you know, from like 6 to 9. Then I might turn into a monster. And luckily I was able to preemptively ask for that boundary rather than that boundary coming through of my monster self coming out and then figuring it out themselves. So it's always great when you can preemptively draw yourself a boundary to your friends rather than wait until you have stretched yourself to them. Okay, so we're going to address a lot of concerns and probably bring up new curiosities and concerns during this talk. And so as we go, I want you all, does everyone have this paper?
About half of everyone.
About half of everyone. Okay. Well, I only see two people that don't have one. Is that true? No. Okay, so what I want you all to do, I did not make enough copies of this, is to share this paper and take notes on your own piece of paper. Does everyone have one within you? Some of these notes? Or this land search worksheet? Anyone not have it within you? Yeah, or you could take a picture with your fancy phone, and then you could, one person could fill it out, and the other person could, like, do something. But these exist, so check them out. And so please take notes. This is a really great and valuable worksheet tool, so I encourage you to write in either on this piece of paper or on your own notebook paper the answers to these questions, your answers to these questions. And I formatted the whole thing in a very, like, personal way, like, how far do I want to be from town? Sort of thing, because it just feels more exciting. Yes, this is happening. Okay. Did I steal this? No. I can give this to somebody. Anybody want one? No. There you go. So, central questions to ask yourself and your family. So this is an overview of what we're going to be covering today. Number one question, is your land going to pay for itself? How far do you want to be from town? How important to you is community? How are you going to implement your land search? What are your ideals for the land itself? Location, size, elevation, geography. You'll see that I've highlighted some things that I think are especially important or emboldened them. Open, flattish land, pasture land, aspect, which means which direction is your hillside facing. So you're probably going to have some hillside if you're buying land anywhere around here. Forest type, whether or not you're going to have a woodlot, the importance of having wild food and game on your land. Water, soils and erosion, toxics, existing infrastructures like roads, logging roads, and fencing, debt traps, and resale value. So this is a very important thing when you go to look for land. Has anyone bought and purchased land before? I know a few people have. So it's really easy to get seduced by
I was seduced by exactly that.
Oh, yeah. And by land in the middle of nowhere, where you're going to be driving an hour to get to town, and it's really easy to see how beautiful the mountain view is and not realize that there's not enough land to have a garden, or that you're on a northern-facing slope and there's nowhere to have a practical house site. So first thing is, check yourself. Will your land pay for itself? So, most likely your land is not going to pay for itself. I hate to break it to you. But especially if you're planning on supporting the land with commercial farming, how much do most growers make per hour? Anybody? Yeah, you know, $2 an hour, $10 an hour, $5 an hour, somewhere in that range. And so, if you want to grow, it's probably a much better idea to lease land if you're needing a lot of land to grow than to try to pay off a mortgage from growing. And so what I suggest is buying yourself an acre or two and then doing longer term leases on farmland, because there's a lot of people who own really nice farmland that are holding onto it because they want it to stay in the family, or you know, for whatever reason, they're holding on to it, and likely they are taking advantage of tax incentives to keep the farm in agriculture. And because they're taking advantage of those tax incentives, it's actually saving them money if they can lease their land, because they're probably not wanting to farm it themselves, to a grower. Does that make sense? Anybody here want to be a grower, a commercial grower? Okay, yeah. So there are ways that you can actually make money growing, but it's not growing field crops. And I just had this funny image of California. Anyway, so in North Carolina, you are not going to be making money growing field crops, most likely. There's some specialty things, maybe you will, but otherwise, you're not going to. And so unless you are coming into this land proposition with a fair amount of money and or financial backing, then please let go of those dreams of paying off your land by selling spinach, because it's not happening. A maple farm maybe could be paying for itself if you find the right high elevation far enough from town that the land's cheap, but you can actually stay on the land. So that's the thing. If you buy land far from town, you need to be able to figure out a way to work from home, because commuting every day 2 hours, totally ridiculous. It just makes no sense. Orcharding can be a way to pay for your land. Retreat centers. That is a way you could pay for your land. Retreat center or a wedding venue, stuff like that. So I went to school for ecological agriculture, and by the time I finished, I was like, wow, I'm never going to try to make my living as a farmer. Got it. I'm going to be a gardener. That's going to be awesome. So how far do you want to be from town? So if you buy land an hour from town, it's going to be less expensive than land 20 minutes from town. But if you're still tied to town, then your dream can become kind of a nightmare. So you're going to be driving to work, or you might be driving your kids to school. You might be driving to the store. Even so, like, I live in kind of this homesteading super hot spot, and even my neighbors, anyone know Kaylin Campbell and Chloe Lieberman? They're really homesteading badasses. Like, I like to homestead, but I also run a school, so I can't grow all of my food. They grow a lot of their food, but they have even been spotted at the food co-op. So, you know, don't think that, oh, I'll just grow all my own food, I won't have to go to the store. You might drive to dance, you might drive to go see friends. Do a cost-benefit analysis of whether it is worth it to pay less money for land further from town. And we'll actually do one of these later on in the class. So, prioritizing community. In my opinion, like, when you saw that list of why you might drive, like, several of these, like, I've figured out the not driving for work. I figured out the not driving for school yet, although we'll see what happens. Driving to the store, we do it like once a week. Driving for social needs, I don't have to, because they all live close by, which is awesome. And so prioritizing community really makes living on land make so much more sense. When I say buy off friends, I don't mean like you like paying your friends to But something that you can do if you want to have land in a community situation is you can get to know people who might have, you know, 20, 30 acres and be like, hey, you know, we're buds. Do you think you might be in a good, and I see that you need money. What do you think about breaking off like 5 acres? So that's totally an option. Buying in a neighborhood with like-minded folks. So that's something that when I was looking for land, I looked at over 250 parcels, by the way. Like, it's a job to look for land. But it's, that job is preparing you for the amount of work it's going to be to have land, especially if you don't get educated first by going to other, living at other people's places or taking classes or whatnot. Like, It's a lot of work to have land. It's a lot. But back to this. So it's a lot less work if you can have work parties with your neighbors, and it's then your work is much more fun and joyful, especially when you go to someone else's place and they just tell you what to do and you don't have to think about it. It's really awesome. So buying in a neighborhood with like-minded folks. So in Barnardsville, you know, like I said, about 7 years ago, we started kind of populating Sugar Creek Road, and some of our neighbors, Peter and Kim, had been there about 15 years, which is what brought different, what brought kind of the first wave of folks there. But now in Barnardsville, all these other neighborhoods of like-minded folks have started popping up all over the place. And it's just so awesome. It's like the best of both worlds, I think, because you have autonomy, but you also can like walk over to a neighbor, which is really nice. But buying land, talking with people who own land, and finding out, like I was telling telling Andrea, like, you know, if I was looking for land and Andrea knew that one of her neighbors was like feeling kind of tired of having her land, that could be an awesome connection. You guys see that? See how that works? It's really cool. Buying and splitting land. So when I went to buy land, we bought land behind Peter and Kama on the same gravel road, but behind them, and three of us split the land. We bought it as one parcel, as 17 acres, and then 1 hour later split it into three parcels. So we had figured this all out way before that hour, you know, at the lawyer's office, but that's supposed to be funny. But, so we had figured all of this out, and then, so it's pretty awesome. We got onto our land with neighbors ready to go, and then we had rights of first refusal on each other's properties, along with deed restrictions that limited, you know, houses to under 2,000 square feet, that limited nuisance animals, that limited all sorts of things. You couldn't have a business that was based on a planer. You guys heard planers much? We can plan our own wood for our own projects, but not a business based on a planner. But that can be a really good option. The trick with that is it's really challenging to do if you need financing. So what we did was the entire 17 acres was $200,000, and we each put our money into one account and then wrote a check for that money to the seller. And we all had either had the money or had private loans, so it was much easier to do that. But if you're working with a bank, that can be more challenging. Joining an existing community. Anyone ever considered joining Earth Haven or anywhere? So like, that can be a really good option. Like, there's definitely bureaucracy and there's definitely some lack of autonomy that happens, but compared to the price of buying land and the headache of trying to figure out getting your social needs met outside of just buying into an existing community, it becomes a really good deal. And I think it's like $20,000 for a house site and like $15,000 for membership after you go through all of the stuff, which compared to, and you get access to hundreds of acres. So I'm not being paid by Earth Haven's like a new member committee or anything, but it seems expensive at first, but then when you do the math and you look at what it would take to make your get yourself access to something like that, it seems like a really good deal. You can go out on your own, like Andrea has done, and you can hope that other people will move close to you. So that's totally an option. You can also form an intentional community. This is probably the biggest headache that you can imagine. But it will also be really great for perfecting communication skills. So the land search. I like to take two approaches in tandem with the land search. I suggest that people focus a lot on social networking so that they can figure out the people that they might want to live next to, or that they might want to live in the same neighborhood as. While I think it's also a good idea to find a good realtor. Some of these pictures I have taken myself, and some of them I totally stole from the internet. So this one I did not make myself, but it's a pretty fun picture. So when you hire a realtor, you are likely to be led on some wild goose chases to pieces of land that are completely unsuitable. This land here is at like 8,000 feet in Washington State or something, and it has a beautiful view of Mount Rainier, but it would be completely unsuitable for a homestead. Just so this is funny again. Tough crowd. So it can be really helpful from your realtor to get parcel numbers and go to GIS before looking at land. Because, I mean, I would go on these epic days with my realtor and go see like six pieces of land all over Madison County and Buncombe County. And it's a lot of driving. And all to get there and be like, no. That's 15 acres of pasture. The pasture's like this. Like it's really helpful to look at GIS. And the topographic maps are very helpful. And for anyone who doesn't know how to read a topographic map, that's what all these lines are. And the lines, which you can add as a layer on GIS, are much closer together where it's steep and further apart where it's more gentle. You guys see that? So that's kind of the basic 101 of how to read topographic maps. I teach a lot more about the mapping during permaculture classes, but we have an hour and a half. So Google Maps is also a useful tool. It does not have topo lines, but it has more detail visually. You can see my leaf garden here. Isn't that fun? So, so Google Maps is also helpful. They have this view that is a 3D view, but I find it to be pretty worthless. It's not very helpful, in my opinion. So, when you're going to look for land, this is another thing, this is a picture off the internet. But I don't think these are Appalachian. Rednecks either. Yeah. Other rednecks. So, maybe from the Ozarks. So, when you go to look at land, ask to camp on it. And camp on it by yourself some, and camp on it with your family some, so that you can hear all the noises that happen through the night. And I've been out looking with clients, and we've heard gunshots for like, you know, an hour and a half straight. Wow, they really like target shooting, don't they? Or anyone ever lived next to hunting dogs? Well, you all are very lucky that you haven't lived next to hunting dogs, because they are kept up in these cooped up little kennels and they bark incessantly. And their barks are bred into them so that like hunters, before they had those weird radio collars, could follow their barks through the forest. Like, this is not something you want to be sleeping next to. Go talk to the neighbors and just feel them out. Don't bring too crunchy of cookies to the farmers. Like, you don't, like, just don't. If you, I don't know how y'all are, but don't let any hippiness out too much, probably. Like, you don't want to necessarily talk about, like, inviting them to some, like, pagan fest or something like that. But I think it's really good to find common ground and meet people where they're at. How many of y'all were born in North Carolina? Okay, a fair number. But most of you weren't. I wasn't. I've lived here 15 years, but I grew up in Washington State, which the country people in Washington State actually are fairly similar to Appalachian country people. But I would say that something that I've really learned is how important autonomy is to people around here. Like, you let them do what they want to do, and they'll let you do what you want to do, and just be good neighbors. But in the process of figuring out if you want to be neighbors with people, you might want to make sure that they're not super racist pricks, you know? But before you move in next to them, as well as that they're not target shooting all the time, or that they have like a really aggressive dog that comes onto the property frequently. Like, these are all things that are important to gauge. And so if the land is beautiful and perfect in all of these different ways, but the neighbors are total jerks, that's not the perfect piece of land. And good for you to figure that out before you purchase it rather than after you purchase it. So, the land itself. So all of this preamble is stuff that I think is just as important as the land itself, and probably is not why you came to class. This is probably why you came to class. So I hope you enjoy. So elevation. If you purchase property at about 1,000 feet, you can grow lots of figs. You can grow Asian persimmons. You can grow mulberries, the Shangri-La mulberry. It's like 5 inches long. You can have a much easier time growing peaches. There's all sorts of things that you can grow at 1,000 feet elevation. I, at that place in the middle of nowhere, lived at 3,800 feet elevation. You can't even grow okra at 3,800 feet. And you can't grow even American persimmons at 3,800 feet. Now I live at 2,200 feet, which is kind of a nice compromise. But at the 3,800 feet, even in the hottest summer day, it was super comfortable. So that's kind of, you know, your trade-off is the higher you go, the summer is more mild. The lower you go, the more you can grow. And so it was really crazy when I moved here from the Pacific Northwest, because there they can grow a lot of things because it only gets down to like 15 degrees. And at where I'm living now, at 2,200 feet, it gets down to -5 really most years. And so, you know, that can make a really big difference. Frost pockets. So if you are wanting to grow an orchard, and what trees are susceptible to late frost? Anyone know what late frost is?
Citrus.
Citrus, for sure. But peaches, apples, pears, what a late frost is when the temperature gets warm and then it goes down again. And where does that happen? In
here.
It happens all the time. Like, do y'all remember a couple weeks ago when it was like 70 degrees? So if you have trees that are on a southern facing slope and they get up to 70 degrees in late February, what do you think is gonna happen? They're gonna open up their buds. And then what's gonna happen to those buds? So that's one piece to say that it can be a good idea to plant your orchard not on a southern facing slope. Maybe on an eastern facing slope, maybe on a northern facing slope. But it's also not the end of the world if your tree's blossoms get killed every few years, because that means that the tree is actually going to be stronger from year to year because it's not putting out fruit every year. Does that make sense? Okay, so, but frost pockets, I want to talk about this. So where is the best growing land on this image? Probably. Where's the best soil? In the bottom. Why? Because over time, over the millions of years that the Appalachians have been here, minerals have been washing from the hillsides down into the valleys. Where does frost settle? In the valleys. I live in a frost pocket. I live at about 2,200 feet, and my neighbors, Kaylin and Chloe, probably live at like 2,500. But they have a nice valley, but it's like on the side of a mountain. It's like a shelf sort of deal. And so they will frequently not have frost, being, you know, hundreds of feet higher, and I will have frost. Isn't that interesting? So if you're planning on making your living doing an orchard of apples or pears or peaches or cherries or anything like that, do you think you want to put it here? No, because the frost, the cool air, settles in the bottoms. It also can settle behind any sort of evergreen hedge or behind buildings, which is really good to know. So this is, some people who know all sorts of things about buying land and about land have been blown away by this concept during this lecture. So is this interesting to anyone?
Yeah.
I'm faking me out.
Is there a way to identify frost pockets without spending an ample amount of time on the land beforehand? Or can you sense certain things?
I mean, usually if you have a valley like this, you're going to have a frost pocket. And this is an excellent time to look for land this time of year, because you can go out on a day when it's kind of, in a, on an early morning, when it's one of those days that could be frozen or could not be frozen, and then you can go and check out whether the piece you're looking at is frozen or not. And my land, actually, it's really crazy, the microclimates. And it's such an effective time to look at those microclimates, is in those in-between times in the fall and in the spring. And the fall and the spring, and especially the early spring, is a really good time to look for land in general, because everything's died back. Like, we live in a jungle in the summertime. It's like, really, has anyone tried tromping through an overgrown field in the summertime? Like, this is not fun. This would definitely not be the outfit to wear. Maybe these boots, but other than that, no. And the wintertime, you can get around super easily. So this is a great time. Okay, so how much land do you really need? This is a huge question, and I actually tell most of my students that if they don't want animals, and if privacy is not a really big issue for them, 1 acre is probably awesome. You can grow, as long as the acre is relatively flat and has relatively good solar exposure, you can grow almost all of the food that you need on that acre, as long as you're not getting into animal agriculture, which needs a lot more land. So the importance of flat land. I gardened for about 10 years on steep slopes, and I had to terrace out every little piece of gardenable land that I could, and that was a lot of work, and it worked really well when I was in my late 20s and early 30s, but now it doesn't cut it. And so I was able to develop this garden space, you know, with help, but was able to develop this garden space, which had really nice soil because it was a little bit of a bottom, because it was flat, flat land. Yeah, there was a lot to be said for a bit of flat land, especially in the mountains. So make sure you scope out the amount of flat land that you're getting when you're raising these animals. Pasture needs. So if you're gonna be raising animals, this is my neighbor and Kaylin, he teaches for a lot of our classes too. So, and Luna, isn't she pretty? So, how much pasture is necessary depends on a lot of factors. One of those factors is the quality of the soil. Another one is whether you're going to be supplementing the feed of the animals, or whether you're going to be trying to grow all of their feed, including their winter feed, on the piece of land you're getting. The amount of rainfall. So, the amount of rainfall that we get in the Southern Appalachians is a lot, and that can actually be pretty depleting to our soils. But it also means that lots of grass grows. So rainfall, the breed of the animals that we're going to have on the land. So generally you will need, per acre, you can get 2 to 8 goats, 3 to 6 sheep, and if you want a cow, then you need about 1.5 to 3 acres per animal. And that's, you know, if you buy 20 acres, you're probably not buying 20 acres of viable pasture. You're likely going to be buying 4 acres of pasture and 16 acres of steep forest. So keep that in mind when you're looking. So aspect, another super important piece to look at when buying land, which again is which way the land faces. This is my land, which faces east. You can see the sun rising over the mountains. So southern exposure. Southern exposure is really sought after by a lot of people. And the best reason, in my opinion, to have southern exposure is so that you can build a passive solar house. passive solar houses work because they have their windows facing in a southern direction, and then they have an overhang that blocks the light coming in the summer and lets the light come in during the winter, because the sun is, of course, higher in the summer than in the winter. I teach long lectures about this during my natural building class, so I'm not going to go too far into it now because we just don't have time. But if you have that bank of windows facing in a direction that is not south, it doesn't work. And if you want to know more about that, you can come to another of my lectures. But that's the basic concept. You can see here, this is on the other side of my land where my apprentices live. They don't live there during the winter. They just live there during the summer because they live in open air structures. But this whole slope is facing east, but it's a bowl, and this part of the bowl faces south, and this part of the bowl faces north, and then the whole thing is facing east. So you can see what a big difference there is between the southern slope and the eastern slope. And in fact, like sometimes during the winter, this will be melted for like 2 weeks, and this is still frozen and has snow. Like the aspect makes a ginormous difference. And I've actually done land consultations where I've gone out, like there was this one woman in particular that I'm remembering, and I went out to her place, and her goals, because I ask people what their goals are, was to grow like 80% of her food. I get out to her place, and she's from California, she loves the sun. Get out to this place, it's this beautiful mountain view, but it's basically this cut out acre that's just been cut out of the mountain, and it faces north. And I look up at the hillside, and I didn't even need the app on my phone, which is a solar pathfinder app. And I look up and I'm like, you know, this place is not going to have any sun at all for 5 months of the year. Like, this is not, you just need to move if those are your goals. And this would be a very wonderful, great place. It was 5 minutes from Marshall. It would be a great place for somebody who didn't care about growing food. But this is just, and who didn't care about the sun. But this is not, like, she suffered from seasonal depression disorder, or whatever it's called, and this is not the place for you. And she sold it, which is great. But yeah, so southern exposure can be really helpful. It can be really dry, super duper duper dry. Like forested slopes are often, that are southern facing, are often in pine. They have very little biodiversity because everything just gets baked. As opposed, to a northern exposure, which is going to be awful for passive solar, but really wonderful for plant diversity. So this is where you want to be growing your woodland medicinals. This is where you're going to have fields full of trillium and ramps galore and just like spring ephemeral madness. So if you're wanting to have part of your land be a nature sanctuary, you know, where you are able to go and just like be in peace and in awe of the beauty of your natural surroundings, then a northern exposure might be a really good idea. Or part of your land being in a northern exposure, which can be awesome if, oh, the markers are gone. Huh, what was this? Oh, wow. That's really cool. So let's say that your land was like, you know, this, and this space is south, and this space is north, and then say you have this other hillside here that faces whatever direction that would be. That would be east, west. If this one's facing, if you're on here, then that would face east. Yeah. So that's really awesome if you're looking at lots of land, and then you put your house here, you have your woodland medicinals here, and then here. Whatever the case is, you
Eraser, that eraser.
Which eraser?
See in the middle, no, in the middle there's an eraser.
Wow, that is amazing. That's scary, pretty amazing. So, the ideal is if you have multiple aspects, but that doesn't always happen. I don't really have that many aspects. Well, no, that's not true. So, Western exposure. This is the exposure for the musicians because they have to work until 2 or 3 in the morning and then they want to sleep in and they don't want to see the sun and they probably aren't growing much of anything anyway because they're musicians and they really want to see the sunset. But it's kind of, in my opinion, it's not where I want to live. And that's largely because in the summertime, you don't get the morning light, but you still get hot. And in the wintertime, you don't get that nice, I mean, it's so good to have sun on you in the morning, in the wintertime. Anyone agree with that? Mm-hmm. And so you don't get that morning sun. Like, I think it's kind of the worst place to put a house. But some people really enjoy the sunset view. I actually grew up in an A-frame that was facing west, but it was really hot. It was like near Portland, Oregon, and it was like stiflingly hot. Eastern exposure, this is my favorite exposure. This is my log cabin. But I don't. With a lot of help. And you can see in the morning, you know, the sun rises first up here where the bedroom is, and then the sun comes down to the rest of the land. I just really enjoy having sun early on in the morning. And I also enjoy that it offers afternoon shade in the summertime because that's when it gets really hot and I want to have some shade. It makes a huge difference. But it's pretty funny in our neighborhood because there's a passive solar house that's right here, my neighbors. And in the wintertime, they're like silent in the sun until like 4:30 or 5 p.m. And I'm out of sun. I do actually have a fair amount of passive solar in this house, even though it's on an eastern-facing hillside, because all these trees lose their leaves in the wintertime, and I have a big window with a bunch of soapstone, a bunch of soapstone under the window. Like, I have a soapstone sill on the window, and so that really captures a lot of heat in the wintertime. And there's also, on the back wall here, there's a clerestory window, and then in the wintertime, the sun comes through that clerestory window and hits the slate and heats it up in the wintertime, which is awesome. But the sun still sets at my place at like 2 o'clock in the wintertime. And so I look over at my neighbors and I'm like, that must be nice. But then in the summertime, I get shade at like 3 and my neighbors are super hot. In some parts of my land, like actually where the outdoor classroom is, gets shaded at like 1:30, which is awesome. And so, yeah, there's pluses and minuses. It just depends on how hot-blooded or cold-blooded you are. Next, we're going to talk about forest types. So there's a lot that we could address with forest types, but what I'm going, like, we can talk about like mixed mesophytic, or we could talk about like pine hickory. We could talk about a tulip poplar dominated forest, but we're not going to talk about that now. We're just going to talk about whether the land, we're simplifying, we're just talking about whether it's a fairly intact forest or whether it is a very disturbed forest, because that's basically the most important
thing. What's that thing called?
What'd you say?
What's that thing called?
It's a pink lady slipper.
Pink lady slipper.
Isn't it beautiful?
I get some of it, yeah.
It's one. You have some?
Yeah.
Nice. There are native orchids. And they're kind of endangered because they were actually used as a medicine in I think, like the 19th century. And so they over-harvested them. So you're very lucky that you have them. So, relatively intact forest. When you're looking at land, you are not going to find trees this big. But the picture is very sweet. This is taken at Joyce Comer. And it's really awesome. But you are likely in the southern Appalachians, even though everywhere here has pretty much been logged, you are going to find a lot of forests that are relatively intact. And that's because a lot of forests were logged but not grazed. And when forests here are logged but not grazed, what happens when you cut a tree? It coppices. It comes up from the roots. It's pretty awesome. And so because of that, you will oftentimes find pretty intact forests in this area, which is really wonderful. But yeah, so if you want to be able, if it's really important to you to be able to go outside and be filled with all those good negative ions and be recharged, and if living in a nature sanctuary is super important to you, then I think buying land that has intact forest is a really good idea. Can be a really good idea. If you're wanting to use your land a lot, like if you're wanting to be getting building materials from your forest, if you're wanting to get firewood from your forest, if you're wanting to have a high level of interaction, then I think it's a better idea to actually get land that's been disturbed. Because as you are interacting with that forest, and I especially encourage my permaculture students to do this, because like hopefully we're all learning tools for land regeneration. Like we want to be part, or I think, I'm not going to say you are, but I want to be part of giving back to the land and of healing the land. Anybody else want to do that? Yeah. And so like this picture shows, I mean, there's also filters involved. This was a kind of crappy picture taken by me, and this was taken by a professional photographer. But you can see the basic idea is like, this is my forest when I moved onto my land about 7 years ago. You can see it used to be a dairy farm, and then the forest grew back super thickly. It's just like when you are sowing carrots and you sow them heavily and then you thin them. And so what we've done is we've done a lot of thinning. We've thinned out a lot of the white pines and thinned out a lot of the red maples, and have taken those and used them for building projects and other things, and also laid the brush on contour lines in the forest. And like the forest has transformed, and we've also brought in some mountain forest soil and brought in a bunch of medicinals, and we brought in over 100 native species onto the property in just 7 years. And it's like, it's really doing awesome. And so to me, being a healer as part of my land journey is really an important piece, rather than being like I just like being able to do some good rather than do bad. Like if you go into an old growth forest, because we are not equipped with the skills that the native people who interacted with that forest so effectively had, we are much more likely to damage it rather than help it. So that's kind of my thinking along those lines. And so, yeah, there's also, if you are going to be building with the materials found on your land, we did a project where we thinned out a lot of pine trees. Like the major species that should be growing on my land is not pine. There should be an oak and hickory forest. But because it was a dairy farm, and because there wasn't that seed bank or that root bank to come back, it came back largely in pines. And so we've been taking out pines and we've been replanting with chestnuts. It's pretty awesome. And then I used these to build a building, a big building. It's pretty cool. You'll actually see pictures of the building later. So a woodlot is important if you're going to be building from the land, or if you are going to be needing firewood. And it's especially important to have firewood if you don't build a passive solar house, or if you move onto a piece of land that has a different house. So another priority can be wild food and game. And this used to be actually a huge priority for me. I used to live in much more intact forest. And I think that some of my promotion of buying disturbed land has to do with my choice to buy disturbed land. And that largely was because it was surrounded by community, and that became more important to me than having the nature refuge in my backyard. But, so, you know, I used to live in a place like this, which was pretty awesome, and you have deer everywhere, although deer actually really like forest edges too. But this picture was taken almost 15 years ago, that's me. And this is milkweed, which usually grows about this tall. And we brought milkweed into our garden and had it growing this tall. So you can take native species and you can bring them in to your garden, and if you're tending them, they can do really well. Wood nettle too, I brought into my land, and even though it wasn't there before, and have really been so happy to see how well it grows if I tend it. So even if you are buying disturbed land, you can bring some of those species in. I've actually planted some ramps on my land too, but they're not doing it. So they've been there like 5 years and they're kind of mediocre. I would never harvest them.
What about the milkweed? Is it good for herbal uses?
It's good for all sorts of things. These flowers,
yeah,
if you cook them, they're super tasty. And the green pods before they make all their fluff are also really tasty. The stalks are really good for fiber. I used to make my living making crafts, and there was a jeweler who I would make cordage for, and she would, and then I also made, I took buckskin deer hide that I tanned and did cords for her, for her various stuff. And so milkweed was one of the fibers that I used for that. It's pretty awesome. And then mushrooms, which you're more likely to find in an undisturbed forest. Water is a really important thing to look at. So springs are awesome. Who wants to live by a creek or a river? Anybody? Yeah, pretty awesome. So, you know, figure out how high of a priority it is to you to live near wild water. Wells, having an established well rather than not having a water source, it's way better to have an established well. Soils. So the soils on a particular piece of land in the Southern Appalachians are most likely to be very depleted because our mountains are millions of years old and they've had millions of years of rain washing all the minerals out of them. And so if you do soil tests, which I've really gotten into this book called The Intelligent Gardener, I would highly recommend it. And it talks about soil remineralization, and the subtitle is Growing Nutrient Dense Food, which I'm all about.
Did you say intelligent or intelligence?
Intelligent. And so while a lot of our soils are going to be very depleted, it's a good idea to test them. And I use this lab called Logan Labs, which gives you a lot more information than the state labs. It costs $25 though to submit a soil sample, but they get it back to you within like 4 or 5 days, as opposed to the state lab, which I've waited over 3 months for it. So if you're considering buying land, I highly suggest that you do soil samples where you're thinking about gardening, and make sure that you're not way up over what you should be for potassium, manganese, and magnesium. Because if you have overabundances of those, it's probably because a past farmer used too much dolomitic limestone, and it can be really hard to correct for that, and it can cause a lot of plant problems. So I would check for those.
What was the three? Potassium, manganese?
Potassium, manganese, and magnesium.
Can I ask, are you suggesting being able to do a soil test before purchasing a piece of land?
Oh, yeah.
So you know what you're working with?
Totally. Totally. So, test for toxics. In preparation for this class, I called a lab, a North Carolina lab that was doing environmental testing, and it's not cheap. Like, if you want to test your soil just for heavy metals, it's like $150 a pop for the test. If you want to test for, like, gasoline and other organics, which are not, you know, what we're thinking of as organics, but like DDT and stuff like that, you're looking at thousands of dollars for all of the various tests. For the water, I think it was $425 to test for everything. For just the metals, I think it was $300. You can, though, also go onto Amazon and you can order lead tests that also test water tests for lead, and they test for other things too. So that I think might be an easier option, at least to start with. And then if you have, like, also it's just not a good idea to buy land that you're gonna farm in like an industrial area. Also, talking to neighbors is a really good plan to figure out if you are, to figure out if you're potentially moving onto land that used to be a tannery, or that used to be a, can anyone think of some horrible
Acoustic.
A what?
Ecusta in Brevard, it was a big chemical cigarette filter plant, and it's a toxic site, and they wanted to put 1,500 units on it in Brevard, but anyway.
So talk to the neighbors. That's probably the best thing that you can do, is talk to the neighbors about that stuff. Existing infrastructure can save you a lot of money, or it can cost you a lot of money. So this is a road that I put in. Gravel roads, I have my notes all together in the top of my brain yesterday, but we'll see if I can remember now. I believe it's between $1,000 and $3,500 for every 100 feet of gravel road to put in. So if you're putting in a mile of gravel road, you're probably looking at like $75,000. And one of my friends actually spent $75,000 on her road, which was longer than a mile, but it was also 15 years ago. So this is a huge expense. And so if you have roads that are going to a house site, that is a really good thing. Buildings or lack thereof. You're probably not gonna find a beer can castle or a bark hut, but you're likely to find a barn. You might even find unfinished structures. So important to look at buildings. You might find a suitable house already on the property. This is an old farmhouse. Make sure old farmhouses are insulated, or you're going to be making plans to insulate the old farmhouse, because likely there's no insulation in the walls. They're just running the wood cook stove all winter. And they're probably a little hardier than us. These are all passive solar houses, which are probably a lot less likely for you to find on a piece of land, but you might, especially in this area. You might find a trailer, or which you might be fine with living with in, or an unsuitable house. I found this blog, it's really cute. McMansion, Halifax. So the trailer or the McMansion. So the trailer can be really useful to live in while you build your dream home. It also, if you can get financing for land that has a trailer on it, it's likely that other people are not going to be able to get financing. So you might get a really good deal on that piece of land. You could also build something around the trailer, and then the trailer could magically disappear at some point, which could be a really great thing. McMansions, if you have the financing figured out, it's possible that you could cut that off and sell it. And that can actually really help to pay for the rest of your land. So that's something to keep in mind. So raw land, you might be looking at raw land. Again, I say, good luck. I bought raw land, it was intense, but it's good. So I would say, if you're buying raw land, start with something temporary or tiny and then build your dream house. So it's really great, actually, and a great way to get equity is to build a tiny house wherever you are now. And then you can roll your tiny house onto your land, which is really great. It can be a really big mistake to keep a rental in town while you're spending your weekends living in a tent and building your house on your land. I'd stay away from that if you can. And start with something small. And if you start with something small too, you can figure out whether you really like building, which is a really good question to ask. Whether you build to code or not to code. So building to code, you're guaranteed to be pretty safe, which is really helpful. Like, if you go messing around with your own wiring, it's very possible that you might burn your house down. And that I do not advise. There's some frustrations with code, though, that it can be really limiting as far as using natural materials and stuff like that. Also, building to code is a much better idea if you are wanting to focus on resale value as part of the reason that you are building. Beyond romance, what it's really like to build. Check out a lot of buildings before you start building. It's really important to see what you like. I think 400 to 1200 square feet is a really good range. Or for a family of 2 to 3, 800 square feet. So I teach a tiny house and natural building class, which is awesome, and largely harnesses people's excitement about tiny houses and the fact that we can complete a build pretty quickly within that time frame. But I don't think most people should actually live in tiny houses, especially if you have a family. I think that I like the like moderate, like not so tiny, but reasonable. I live in a 600 square foot house with my family, which is great. Building will take over your life. You should start with a shed. If you're working with contractors, always get referrals, especially if those contractors are your friends. Bids are way better than estimates. So if you're able to get a bid, which is where someone's like, this will cost $125,000, versus getting an estimate where someone says, this will probably cost $100,000. Go with the bid. Let's see here. It usually takes 2 times the money and 2 times the time that you estimate to build anything when you first start building. I like to build with income streams, starting small first, but planning for additions. Start buying double pane unfrosted windows as soon as you can. Because windows and doors will kill you. They're so expensive. And so if you can accumulate them used over time, rather than being like, okay, it's time to build. Now we need to get a bunch of windows. That's not the time. Organize work parties for other people first, and then they will be obligated to come to your work party. And we have a tiny house class August 17th through 25th, and it's an awesome place to start the journey. So avoid debt traps. Consider just buying 1 acre. Consider whether you actually really need that steeper forested land. Consider splitting land and consider your time. Clustering work, school, and home makes sense. Picture a 45-minute commute or 45 minutes of additional commute 5 days a week. Consider paying yourself at a rate of $20 an hour. Let's say you commute 50 weeks of the year. The math comes to $7,500 a year just for your time, not counting gas or wear and tire on your vehicle. This could be $625 a month towards a mortgage that you could pay more for a mortgage if you lived 45 minutes closer to work or your kid's school, or $625 a month that could be subtracted from the income you would need to make to live to work at home if you live far out in the country. Isn't that crazy? When you really do the math, and I encourage you to do the math on various places, especially if you're thinking about living really far away. So we're not gonna have time today, but when you go home, I really encourage y'all to take a picture of that sheet, and if you haven't been during the class, do it later. Take time to prioritize your preferences. Is your land going to pay for itself, or do you need to supplement? How far are you gonna be from town? How important community is? Elevations, frost pockets, if they're important to you or not. Open flat space with good solar, pasture land, aspect, forest types, woodlot, wild food and game, water, soils, toxics, existing infrastructure, buildings, debt traps, and resale value. So, really briefly, we're going to talk about your first year. Sound exciting to anybody? Okay, so the first year, make no big moves. So I'm not super against heavy machinery, but I think it's really important that you spend a lot of time on the land and actually do small projects with the heavy machinery after 1 year. And then maybe after you've been there for 5 years, then you start putting in big roads and stuff like that. Okay, and yeah, so no big moves. Also, don't go and plant your orchard in your first year. Wait, make sure that you know where you want things to be. This is a really important thing that I drive home during permaculture classes. Is like, it's great planting a tree. The best time to do it was yesterday. But you want to make sure that it's going in the right place. So what to do in the first year? Observe and interact with your land. Do an grow an extremely tiny garden. Just piddle around with it. Do brush on contour on forested land. Get soil tests from lots of different places on your land and remineralize your soil using the Intelligent Gardener book. Make friends out of neighbors. Get lots of opinions, friends, mentors, neighbors, Wild Abundance, I do land consultations, and Organic Grower School also does land consultations. But it can save you, I do land consultations, that's like a big part of what I do. And what was the first thing that I did when I bought land? I hired other people to come and get another perspective on my land. Keep things largely as they have been. Like if someone else is grazing on your land, you want to keep that going for a year. And watch for perennials, because it's likely that some old lady or old man has planted some beautiful things, or asparagus, or whatever, that you're not going to know about until you wait. We're going to have questions in just a minute.
What do you mean, do brush on contours?
I talked about it, but you were too busy making sweet eyes at someone. I think I talked about it, but I couldn't help myself from saying it. So, I did talk about it. What you do is you take thinnings from the forest and you put it on contour lines, and that helps stop erosion and it builds soil. It's a really awesome strategy. So take classes. This is a really good strategy during your first year on that land when you're like, oh, I want to do this, oh, I want to do that. But really you just need to chill out and gather information. So the Organic Grower School offers lots of classes. Soil out at Earth Haven offers awesome classes. Wild Abundance, I think, offers especially awesome classes. We do an apprenticeship program if anyone is not yet buying land. It's a 3, 4, or 7 month program. We offer different programs. And it really gets you like deep into what it's like to live on land. We do a wild edibles and foraging adventure in the spring where you can learn all about up to like 80 wild foods. We do women's carpentry classes, and we also offer a tiny house and natural building class in August, but I don't have one of these fancy things for it, so I just had to write it out. There is a flyer, though. And this class is probably the best class that you could take your first year on land, or if you are looking at buying land, is the Earth Skills and Permaculture class. And it's a permaculture design certification course, but it's designed as a 1 weekend a month program, and it starts at the end of April with the wild foods hike, and it's awesome. Okay, so you have got this. Feel prepared for your land search, feel ready, you can do it. The first thing that you need to do is just start looking. And before you hire a real estate agent, interview them, check them out, give them like a trial period, because if you sign a contract with them, you are committed to them for a year. So you really need to figure out if they're actually going to show you anything worth seeing, which is honestly probably not likely unless they're really awesome. So really try that out. And now we are open for questions. Yes?
So about that realtor. So if you were looking for land and you have so much experience, why in a way wouldn't I just hire you instead of them, because you'd be more familiar with kind of growing the organic and what's on the property versus an average realtor, unless I guess they're an environmental specialist of some kind. So, I mean.
Well, realtors are familiar with all the different parcels that are on the market.
Right, and so they can help with that, but not so much with the quality of
the Yes, land. Exactly. The realtor is not going to be super helpful for you for bringing
right.
out the quality of individual land. So what I tell people is that it would be way too expensive to hire me to go and see every piece
right.
that they go and look at. So what I suggest is that they narrow it down. You know, they look at like 30 pieces or 40 pieces or 50 pieces, and then they find their favorites, and their favorite one or two or three, and then they hire me or someone from OGS to come out and look at those pieces that they are really excited. And then I can, or they can, give you the thumbs up or the thumbs sideways or the thumbs down, based on your needs.
Right.
And, you know, I've been actually encouraging my permaculture students for years that someone should become a permaculture real estate agent, but I haven't had any bites.
Awesome. Because that's like, that's what I would consider hiring too. It'd be critical if I want to grow things that I would
totally
understand.
Totally. And there's this guy, Pat Snyder, who I have liked pretty well. And he has been used by some of my land consultation clients, and I think he's pretty good.
Thanks.
Yeah. Anybody else? Questions? Wow, did I really cover everything that well?
Yeah.
No questions? Yeah.
I think it was a couple slides back in the first year of, you mentioned different revenue streams.
Build towards income streams.
What, back one more. Here. Now, right here.
Yeah.
The fourth to last. I like to build with income streams. So
yeah.
What are
so like, I like to build as I have money. So like, if I saved up $5,000 in a year for building, I would build with that $5,000. Or if I saved up $20,000 and over the course of 5 years, I would build with that rather than taking out loans for building. And that I've just had the experience that when I do build with an income stream, then I keep things much more reasonable. And I, for one of my buildings, I have like 15 buildings of various sizes, some are very tiny, but I took out a loan for $30,000 from a family member, and I blew through that money. And whereas like my cabin, the first phase of my cabin was $5,000, you know, and then this new building, which is much larger, but I mean, it's, and then I'm still spending.
Right.
And so I think that it can be really easy to hire out and to just try to get things done fast if you are taking out loans, but then that means that you have to spend so much time away from your land to pay back that loan. And so that's why I say that. It's a little different. Like when I was doing most of my building, I didn't have kids, you know, and so it was easier to build with my income stream. But yeah. Anybody else? Any questions? No. Wow. Okay. Cool. Well, I hope you all.
An extra one if anybody wants.
Oh, great. Cool. Extra handout. So I encourage y'all to really take your time, and also keep in mind that you won't find the absolute perfect place. And I'm excited to email y'all that bonus worksheet that you will take, if you want to the pieces of land, to mark out, like, what is the forest type? Like, how many acres of flatland does this have? How many acres of this? It can just be really helpful for organizing your land search. So if you want that, make sure you sign up on the newsletter list. And